We're here at the Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies talking to artist Nate Powell about his work on the recent book, March. Thanks so much for being with us.
I'm glad to be here. Thanks, man.
Now, there was a panel discussion this morning on visualizing peace, graphic art, and social change that you participated in. Talk a little bit about the importance of March and how that essentially helps with the whole notion of promoting social change.
Oh, certainly. I mean, you know, simply enough, March is the graphic novel memoir of one of our living, you know, icons in the struggle for human rights. So my function as the visual artist is simply to be not only faithful to his personal and subjective experiences and, you know, those of the people around him, but also to sort of pick up on what's between the lines in the script, pick up on the emotional and personal nuance that'll make it resonate with people in a particular way. I guess because of the gravity of the project, I don't personally feel that, let's say, I personally bear the obligation to, you know, directly impart the kind of inspiration or social change that Congressman Lewis does. I think he does that just fine on his own. So it's inspiring to me, and also a little bit of a relief just to be able to more or less execute his vision in a way that resonates with me first as a creator who's extremely stoked to be doing it, but then also, yeah, feel it begin to ripple out as the release time draws nearer and nearer.
All right. Well, your work is seems to me uniquely suited for a project like this, you know, with any empire in particular, Swallow Me Whole. How did you get engaged in the project?
Well, I'd been working with Top Shelf since about 2005, and I've had a maybe 15-year-long relationship of correspondence with Chris and Brett. They're great folks, and they've put out several of my books. So I guess I'd seen a press release that they signed March as a project without an artist. And I was like, oh, yeah, I remember that. And I had my own thing going on, lots of work to catch up on. But Chris Staros gave me a call one day and was like, Nate, I think that you might be the proper artist for this. You should think about, you know, submitting some demo pages from the script to see what the writers think about it and see if it would work out. And a lot of it, I guess, was being able to approach things in a representational and realistic way, visually speaking, but also remaining animated and iconographic enough of a cartoonist to make things seem lively and not dry. You know, we've all seen, you know, like non-fictional comics works or stuff that tries to serve a serious purpose that really kind of falls on its face when it tries to be, well, when it winds up being dry enough. It's like, oh, come on, man. You're not doing anybody any favors. You're still telling a narrative. You're still producing a comic book.
Talk a little bit about the process that you're using for something like this that is a historic work, you know, that is based on the actual life experience of somebody, because I'm quite sure that, you know, there are all sorts of historical documents, photos, you know, that you're using as conventional points of reference.
Oh, yeah, I mean, it's extremely reference and research heavy. The best thing about it is that the primary source of a lot of this is Congressman Lewis himself, you know. So going into it, you know, right off the bat, I just dove into Walking with the Wind, his excellent memoir that he did about 15 years ago. You know, managed to watch some videos, also, you know, hung out with him, went on the pilgrimage, and I've, you know, had a chance to see him speak in person and on TV to get a sense of his own personal storytelling style. I'm working from a script that he and Andrew worked up. But, you know, John Lewis is primarily an oral storyteller, and some of these tales he's been telling for 45, 50 years. So a lot of it was, I guess, working with the specific way he already tells these tales. And when I'm going from the script to the page, you know, I definitely spend at least an hour a day just Googling things. A lot of stuff is, you know, detail-oriented. It has to do with storefronts, the way a downtown looked in 1960 that might be completely transformed today, clothing, cars, etc. I'm also a Southerner, grew up in Arkansas, Mississippi, and Alabama, so a lot of the environmental aspects are home to me. And that's also very refreshing and wonderful feeling to be able to be like, okay, all right, so we're in Alabama now. And being able to pull a little bit of myself into the project as well.
This is the first of three books, right?
Right. Yeah, it's a trilogy. We're shooting for late 2014 for volume two. Yeah, the next two volumes are a little thicker. They're way darker and more brutal. I'm about 20 pages through penciling book two right now. So a lot of it is just keeping the nose to the grindstone and working through it.
In closing, talk about why you feel this is an important work.
Well, I guess a lot of this, you know, like from the time I basically was old enough to really recognize a moral compass or whatever, you know, as a white middle-class Southerner, I grew up with a specific perspective on Southern American racism and its legacy. But a lot of that was stuff that, you know, it's the 1980s or it's the 1990s. This was something that happened when my parents were in high school or in college. And we would discuss it a lot, but, you know, as I developed my own voice, my own way of questioning and thinking, I have also taken for granted that this is something that's perpetually in the minds and hearts of young people. And really wasn't until I got into the nuts and bolts of drawing March that I realized that, you know, people that we take for granted, such as Rosa Parks' legacy, or, you know, exactly what Malcolm X or even King did, these are things that you can't trust a 20-year-old or a 15-year-old just to know. You know, if someone's born in the 1990s, there has been enough of a generational shift, even between my generation and that generation, that, I had to acknowledge that I was taking certain aspects of my own history and, you know, my own culture for granted. So I think in terms of a generational shift, we're talking about something extremely important in imparting this history to other folks.